I think this morning we're going to start in Proverbs chapter 3. Got your Bibles this morning? Proverbs chapter 3. I want to make a couple, just some quick couple announcements that your benefit as we're getting situated here this morning. Hey Dan, when you get done, why don't you adjust this camera here? Tilt it up. No, down. 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 What? More. What? No. Yeah. Okay. A little bit higher. All right, that's fine. As long as they can see something and hear something, we're good. Maybe tilt, go pan that way. There you go. All right, we're live, of course. It started last week going live broadcasting on Periscope, so we're just adjusting the camera. This is not TBN or Daystar. We don't have anybody back in the production room calling the shots and several cameramen. We do everything on our own. But anyway, I just want to encourage you, if you haven't done it yet, people here watching by the internet or here at the church, get you a, if you got a smartphone and you got a Wi-Fi connection, anybody can do it, get a Periscope app, download it. Probably have to get a Twitter account, because if you follow me on Twitter, anytime I go live, you'll get a notification. Friday night, I was studying, doing some praying, and I just felt like, well, I'm going to go live, see what happens, you know? Because we are going to try to start doing the No Religion Zone throughout the week, once a week at least, and that's a program we had on the radio. But anyway, so I did it without any, you know, calling anybody or, you know, advertising or anything. And we had 71 people just pop on just like that. So, you know, it's beneficial. It's a great technology that we can utilize for the kingdom of God, of course. But I said all that to say this. I never know. I may go live tonight. I don't know what I'm doing. Just whenever I feel like it or inspired to. And if you're not doing anything, you'll see that notification, and you can just open your app, your Periscope app, and then watch. But if you don't, on the Twitter account, they save the videos where you can watch it at your convenience. And I don't know how long those videos will be up there. I've heard different things, and I haven't really sought it out to figure out if they're up there for 24 hours, 48 hours a week, or permanently. I don't know. But no matter what I do, we're always recording it off the computer too, so it'll also go up on YouTube, whereas it will be there permanently. So that's just the announcement. And you really don't even have to watch, period. You don't even have to come to church. As you've noticed, half the congregation is missing. They don't even have to come to church. You can go to another church if you want. I'm just doing my thing. Whatever God's calling me to do, I'm doing it. And you can join it, or you can, whatever the Spirit leads you to do. All right? I have three messages this morning that I'm going to combine into one. I don't know how it's going to turn out, but we're going to go for it. In Proverbs chapter 3, if you got your Bible there, I don't know what verse it is. What verse is it where it says trust in the Lord? Verse 5? Yes. Trust in the Lord? All right, just keep your finger there. And go to Romans chapter 8. I'll get to Proverbs chapter 3 here shortly, but I want to start at Romans chapter 8. And I think it's verse 2. I'll go ahead and read it. Romans chapter 8, verse 2. Now, while I'm turning there, the Bible is pretty clear on we have to admit that we're sinners, and we have to admit that we're in need of a Savior. Right? John, 1 John chapter 1 or 2 says, if we say we're without sin, we're lying and deceiving ourselves. The purpose I'm saying that is there is a confession that needs to take place out of every believer's life or lost person's life before they get saved. And that is they have to confess their need of a Savior, because also confessing they're missing the mark, which is sin. If you don't confess that, you're not even going to come to Jesus, because you're not going to see a need for Him. You're not going to see that you're a sinner. You're not going to see that you need a Savior. So it's kind of like an automatic thing. When the Spirit of God comes on a person, they get that awareness. It's called repentance. They turn around. They change the way they think and feel and walk to some degree. And then at that point, now I'm going somewhere with this, so don't get bored. I got to lay a foundation. I'm not just going to jump into this thing. You know, one thing I don't do, I hate doing, if I'm in a pool, I just don't jump in. I can't do it. It's too much of a shock. Who has to put the foot in first? Yeah. And then just ease your way in, cussing as you go in. I can't just jump in a pool or lake or river. I got to ease into it, unless it's really, really warm. Well, I'm not just going to jump into this thing, because it's just, you're like, what, wait, whoa, what, where are you going with that? I'm just going to ease you into this thing. So you got to admit something. You got to confess something. Your sin, missing the mark, and your need of a Savior because of the missing of the mark. Jesus says to Nicodemus, you must be born again. Now his response would be, what do you mean I got to be born again? I can't go back in my mother's womb, climb up in there for 9 months, and then come back out and go, oh, I'm born again. Now that's Nicodemus' response. That's ludicrous, of course, but he had no grid to operate off of. He had no clue what Jesus was talking about when he said you must be born again. Most Christians don't even know why they got to be born again. They've never really been taught what that term means. So what is Jesus saying to Nicodemus when he says you must be born again? He's saying, I'm not talking about a physical birth. That already happened. Whatever date you were born. That already happened. He's talking about a supernatural birth. How many knew that? What does that mean? Born of the Spirit. Look at Romans 8, verse 2. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ has set me free from the law of sin and death. Let me just turn this around a little bit. What's he saying? The law of the supernatural, because the Spirit is all about the supernatural. Right? The law of the supernatural has set me free from the law of the natural. Now, what do you have to admit? I'm not asking you to admit you're a sinner this morning. You already did that. I'm not asking you to admit your need of a Savior. You already did that too. You know, the 12-step program of any type of deliverance, alcoholism, what's the first thing they say you have to admit? That you're an alcoholic. You've got to admit that. Otherwise, what the hell are you doing in there? If you don't think you need it, and you're not that, why are you there? So any 12-step program requires you to admit something's wrong with you. You don't admit that, there's no help. You've got to admit. And it's hard to admit stuff. I mean, everybody here, or at least most of us here, have been married. And when your spouse is pointing out your weakness, that's a hard thing to admit. Yeah, you're right. Because my thing is, I want to turn it back on them, and I want to speak Jesus to them. Why don't you take out the speck or the big plank in your own eye before you try to take out the speck that you're pointing out in mine? I want to be on the offense at that point. It's really hard to shut that defensive mechanism down and say, yeah, you know what, you're right. I am a jerk. I'm this, I'm that, what you're saying. But my point in that is, there's no basis for exchange if you're going to stay in denial. You're not going to get any further in your relationship if you are going to deny what the other person is saying. They may not be exactly right, but there's got to be some truth in what they're saying, or you've married a flat-out liar. And that's a whole nother problem. You got to admit something. Now, I'm taking my long way around to this. How many understand the confession of you got to admit the deal, right? I want to share with you, in my opening, like I said, I got three messages today. This is the first one. Something the church refuses to admit. It's what Jesus said to Nicodemus. You must be born again. Romans 8. You've got to understand that when you got born again, you entered into a realm that's supernatural. And you died to the realm of natural. Jesus said, I am crucified under the world. The world is natural. Right? Jesus said, I died to the law. The law, four secrets, two keys, do this, don't do that. That's all natural. Romans 6, I died to sin. That's natural stuff. If I go out today and sin, that's natural. That's my natural bent to do certain things. My natural bent is not alcoholism. You may not believe that. I'm not an alcoholic. I am not addicted to any chemical, thank God, by the grace of God, not condemning anybody that is. I've never been addicted to chemicals or drinks or smokes or any of that kind of stuff. I don't have that addictive personality in those areas. I can partake without being addicted. You understand that? But that's all natural stuff. Now, there are people that have a bent toward alcoholism, but that's all your natural life. That's super. Now, wait a minute. I know people that aren't saved that are alcoholics, so that's natural. That's not a supernatural thing. That is natural, right? But when you get born again, you enter into the realm of the supernatural, thus no longer living a natural life, but a supernatural life. You say, well, I don't know why would the church have a problem admitting that? Here's what you and I have a problem admitting. I am supernatural. Why do we have a problem admitting that? Confessing that to one another and believing it for ourselves. Why? You may sit there right now and say, I know I'm supernatural. Then why do you live natural? Why do you keep weighing pros and cons? Why do you keep looking at things with a worldly mentality and through education, information, philosophy, all this worldly wisdom that gets piped down to us through every means possible anymore, trying to conform us into their image, thus renewing the mind? Why is it that everything we do is always calculated if we are supernatural people? I shared with you last week, I didn't calculate buying that vehicle. That's God speaking it, God saying do it, God opening up the door, God giving me the vehicle that I even like. I'm very picky about driving. I want to drive something I like. And then making the way. And I walk away from that thing saying, I didn't calculate anything. I didn't even make the decision. It was told to me, it's time. I didn't go to God browbeating him over a vehicle. That's supernatural. Now, why can't every area of our life be supernatural? Where you can't take any credit and you can't take, you can't calculate anything, because the minute you start calculating, you get into where you engineer and orchestrate a ways and means to get something, and that's all flesh. That's natural. See, if God does it, then you got to put the worry on Him. You do it, you better worry, because you're the one that started that ball rolling, and you're going to have to keep it going. That's why I'm very timid about starting anything. I want to make sure it's God. If it ain't God, I don't want it started. And again, I'm going to drill this into your head. I'm going to say it a zillion times, not a million, but a zillion times, till you get it. John the Baptist in John chapter 3 says, I don't want it if it doesn't come from heaven. If it doesn't come from heaven, it's not mine to have. That's car, that's job, that's a mate, that's anything. That God's not initiating, if He's not initiating it, I don't want to have anything to do with it. I have to admit that I'm supernatural, and I take my cues from that realm of supernatural, which means today, if you hear His voice, Hebrews chapter 3, God will initiate by opening doors, speaking to you, and until then, you wait. Or get in the flesh, use the natural abilities that you're born with, the first birth, born with natural abilities and IQs and learning, education and wisdom and information. Work that system. That system's out there to be worked. But understand, it's very limited and can turn around and bite you in the rear end and not pay off. We call those Ishmaels, which I'll get into that here in a second. Go through the Bible. God does not resort to natural means. I'm going to look at two individuals, but let me tell you, the first one is Moses. Moses is in the wilderness. He just killed a man. He's a murderer. Thou shalt not murder, right? He's a murderer. And he has to flee the country or he'll be killed. This is holy Moses. God's deliverer for Israel gets ahead of the program. Tries to deliver Israel in the flesh and starts doing it his way. I'll start by killing somebody. I'll get this revolution going. I'll create a riot. And it doesn't work. He has to flee. So he's in the wilderness for 40 years. 40 years! Yeah, but in the old days, they lived longer. Oh, he only lived 120. The average guy today is 70 to 80. What, he only got tacked on another 30, 40 years? That goes by like that. So 40 years, he was 40 years old when he killed that guy. And then he spends another 40 years in the wilderness, and as you read it, as far as he's concerned, his life is over. He's tending sheep now. He's a shepherd. He marries this woman, Zipporah, or Zipper, I don't know how you want to pronounce it, and her dad's name's Jethro. Not Jethro Tull. And Jethro has sheep. Now he's working for his wife's dad. I mean, it's bad enough that you're a murderer, a fugitive, and you got to work for your wife's dad. Who wants to work for their wife's, their father-in-law? I've had father-in-laws. I wouldn't want to work for them. That's pretty, I mean, the man got nothing. His riches comes from his wife's side of the family. He's dirt poor. He's a murderer. I mean, what kind of life, I mean, it's over for him, right? He's screwed. He ain't getting no, he's not going anywhere. Have you ever made mistakes in the past that's put you like up against the wall and there's no options and you got to settle with whatever you got after the dust settled, you have to settle with? And you've got scars now and you've got a bad reputation. Now you got to deal with it. I'm limited. I can't get certain jobs because of what I did in the past. I can't live in a certain tier because I can't make that kind of money anymore, maybe because of something I don't know. But Moses in the natural is screwed. You ever feel like, I'm done. I got no opportunities. I got no education. I didn't go to college. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. And now I'm limited to minimum wage, McDonald's, Burger King, Hardee's, you name it. I'm limited to it. Or welfare. What's God do with Moses? Does God work with Moses through the natural realm? Uh-uh. Moses is tending sheep, and he looks over, and what does he see? Huh? Oh, you learned this in Sunday school. A burning bush. And it doesn't consume the bush. It's on fire, but it doesn't consume the bush. It's like, okay, it's like a tree. You see a tree, a pine tree on fire. You ever see a pine tree on fire? Whew, it goes, it'd be like looking at a pine tree on fire, but the pine tree's not being burned up. So that gets his attention. So he walks over to it to check it out. What gives here? And the thing starts talking to him. The bush starts talking to him. That's supernatural. And God restored that man through a supernatural means. If you're looking for a natural way to fix your life, forget it. If you're born again, God's not going to let you find a natural way. So don't look at, well, so-and-so did this. Why don't you try it? No, you got to go to God and wait for Him to speak to you, not through a burning bush, but through the Holy Spirit who has been given to you and you've been sealed by once you're saved. Right? So does God start with the supernatural with Moses and then revert to the natural? No, He says, go back to the place you killed that guy. And then I want you to say to Pharaoh, the king of the most powerful nation of that day, Egypt, and say, let my people go. Now Moses stuttered. He says, I can't even speak. I can't speak now. You want me to speak before a powerful king? God says, you're going to go. I don't care if you have a speech impediment or not, you're going to go. And you're going to speak to this Pharaoh. And you're going to say to him, let my people go. They had been in slavery for 400 years. That's their milk and bread. They're not going to let them go. That's how they make money, putting these slaves to work. They built all their city, and their economy got big on the back of these slaves. You think they're just going to let them go? That'll mess their economy up. So this is a big feat. I mean, this is just something. It's not just some easy thing. He goes in there, oh, yeah, okay, and he's out. No, this is going to be huge. And Moses is not going to be able to convince Pharaoh and break the back of the most powerful. I mean, can you imagine going over to Russia, getting an airline ticket, and going over to Russia and telling Vladimir or whatever his name is, let Poland go or stop your aggression? What's Lebowski say? This aggression has got to... How's he say it? This aggression will not stand, Putin. Huh? You going to be able to do that? Who the hell are you? Same thing. Who's Moses? God getting Moses to go to Pharaoh is be like you getting a plane ticket, because God told you, and go over there and set that man in Russia straight. Would you be trembling in your knees? I would, for this reason. Will I get back? Well, I mean, I get there, but am I going to get back? What's going to happen to me over there if I cause a riot over there? I mean, he just didn't walk in there through the back door and get kicked out like a guy trying to jump the fence at the White House and then gets kicked out or whatever. He created a riot. A revolution. He got these people stirred. And there are millions of these slaves. You can't do this in the natural. But God didn't start it in the natural. And turn to Galatians chapter 3. God didn't start this thing in the natural with Moses. It starts with a burning bush. He goes into Egypt. Now, does Pharaoh bend over backwards for him? You know the story if you've seen the movie, The Ten Commandments. Does Pharaoh bend over backwards for him? No. So now, put yourself in Moses' shoes. Lord, why couldn't you give me favor with Pharaoh? Have you ever asked for favor? I'm going to get this job interview. God, will you give me favor with this boss? And while you're getting interviewed, the boss hates you. You can tell it on his face. He just doesn't like you. Why couldn't God give Moses favor with Pharaoh? Why does Pharaoh kick him out of the courts? Huh? Why couldn't it went easy for him? It's hard enough to be able to get the plane ticket and go over to Russia. Just give me favor with Putin and let me just get what I got to do and get out. This is the thing about God. And again, there are things about you people don't like. And there's things about me you probably don't like. But I got to tell you something. If I'm going to be really honest, there's things about God I don't like. I'm serious. And this is one of them. It was tough enough for Moses to do what he had to do to get back to Egypt where he was a murderer. He could have been thrown in jail. There's that guy that killed the Egyptian, put him in jail, and it's over. He had to trust that God would not put him in jail or allow Pharaoh to put him in jail. But why doesn't God give Moses favor with Pharaoh? Now, Pharaoh doesn't like Moses. And he's so mad that he takes the straw away from the people so they can't make bricks as easy as they used to. Now Pharaoh makes it harder on the people to work. And the people say to Moses, now Pharaoh's rejecting Moses. This guy's going with a promise. He's got a promise from God that he's going to be the deliverer and God's going to deliver those people out of 400 years of bondage. Moses is going back to Egypt with a promise from God. And he gets rejected by Pharaoh. And when Pharaoh does what he does to the people start rejecting Moses. Huh? I mean, it's not working. Pharaoh doesn't like him. Now his own people don't like him. So God creates these plagues, makes it harder. The first plague doesn't work. Second plague doesn't work. Third plague doesn't work. And it's like, how long is this going to go on? This charade, God? Did you not call me here? Let me tell you something. God makes it hard. This is what I don't like about him. He's going to give you a promise and then make it hard. Put a pause on that. Let me give you another illustration. It's not God so much making it hard. Here's how God makes it hard for Joshua going into the land of Canaan. I want you to go around the city seven times. One time a day, and on the seventh day, seven times. And then you're going to blow trumpets, and then the walls are going to come down supernaturally. Just go through the Bible. The Red Sea splitting, supernatural. Them crossing the Jordan, supernatural. You go through the Bible. God does not work through natural means. And this is where you got to come and admit you are not natural. What does Galatians 3:5 say? Anybody can read.
Then does he who supplies you.
Okay, verse 3. Wrong verse. Verse 3. Yep.
Are you so foolish, so senseless?
All right, stop. Paul's going to ask you a question. Are you so foolish and senseless? Why? What would make me be a fool and senseless? What would I have to do to be foolish and senseless? What's he say?
Having begun your new life spiritually.
Having begun your life in the spirit, which is supernatural. Finish. And now, are you going to think you're going to pull this thing off by going back to the natural? you don't have to admit it. You can walk out of here today and go back to the natural, but you're foolish and senseless to think that God starts this thing off with you supernaturally and that you are going to finish it by means of the natural. This I don't like because, let me give you an example. I hope I can pull this off. Now let me now evolve into message number two. Why does God do this? He gives a promise to Abraham. I'm going to get back to Moses. If I don't, remind me to get back to Moses. He gives a promise to Abraham. I'm going to open up probably three stories here and let them linger out there, and I'm going to try to close them all off at the end. So Moses is number one. But he gives Abraham a promise that he's going to be a father of many nations. I know you already know this. I know you're smarter than me on this. I get that. But walk with me with this, okay? He tells Abraham, I'm going to make you a father of many nations. But Abraham has a problem in the natural. What's Abraham's natural problem? Is it his IQ doesn't work right? Is he born on the wrong side of the tracks? How is he going to be a father of many nations if he's got a problem? What's his problem? He's not impotent. What's his problem? His wife is barren. How dare you? That's insensitive. To make a promise to me that I'm going to have a bunch of kids when you know darn well my wife has a closed up barren womb. Is he just... I think that's insensitive. You don't know our problem. She's kind of like handicapped. And you're gonna make a promise to me that can't happen. But Abraham believed God. That's faith. In spite of her closed womb, I'm going to believe what you're saying. Because you're God and you can do anything. All things are possible to them that believe what they hear God say. Anything's possible. All God has to do is whisper it. All God has to do is decree it. And it becomes possible. Right? So, does her womb get open the next time they have sex? Second time they have sex, does her womb get open? Third time they have sex, does her womb get open? Now we're in the month, and it's her cycle. She's not pregnant. So second month. She's not pregnant the second month. She does get pregnant the third month. Well, how about in a year? Does she get pregnant in a year? At that point, I'm going to start saying, wait a minute now, you made a promise here. And there's nothing that I can do to open up her womb. I ain't no doctor. Third year, fifth year, eighth year, tenth year. Does anybody know how many years it took for that woman to get pregnant? I'm sorry, I ain't got 25 years to wait you out. That's just too... And, you know... Understand, I'm not trying to be funny here, but you got to understand, I get mad at God a lot. My flesh does. I'd say, God, that is way damn too long. Give me the promise when it's 5 years away. Don't give me the promise now and have to make me wait 25 years. Well, this gets so bad, the waiting. He doesn't get even it's going to be 25 years, so he can at least settle into it. Every year he's thinking, is this the year? Nope. Next year, is this the year? Nope. Is it going to happen this spring? Nope. Going to happen next spring? Nope. How about the fall? Nope. God doesn't tell him how long it's going to take. And it wears him down. Why does God do this? Why does he tell Moses to go do some impossible feat and then not even back him up? Now he's got Pharaoh rejecting him. He's got the people, his own people rejecting him. And when he finally lets them loose, he's up against the Red Sea. How are you going to get across the Red Sea? Oh, you know the story. It gets split, but he doesn't know that. See, it's easy to have hindsight with the Bible. And you got to get rid of hindsight when you read the Bible, or you're never going to get the true understanding. You got to put yourself in the shoes of these guys. It's easy to read Moses, the story of Moses, because you know how it ends. But what if you don't know how it ends? You're going to get mad at God and say, why are you doing this to this guy? Why are you making it so hard on Pharaoh? Why are you making it hard on the people? Okay, fine. You got them out. To take them to a Red Sea they can't cross? Mountains on each side, and Pharaoh changes his mind. And now he's coming after them. Again, God puts them in a place where they're screwed. God will always put you in a place where you're screwed. I'm sorry. I'm tired of it, but it never stops. It's his way, it's his principle, and I wish he wasn't like that. So what does Abraham do in their 13th year of waiting? I don't know, whatever year. His wife comes up with the idea, let's help God out. Now remember, God starts this thing with a supernatural promise. Your wife will have a kid. The only way she's going to have a kid is if God supernaturally heals her, right or wrong. Because there's no physical pill you can take. There's no physical incantation you can speak over her. It's either God opens it or it doesn't happen. Right? But they come up with a natural means. We've got this woman called Hagar. She is your servant, your maidservant. Take her into the tent, have relations with her, and then when she gets pregnant, at least your side, your genes, will be there, and it'll be your kid. That's how bad they wanted a kid, that they tried to help God out with the promise. So Abraham, and you've heard me say this, he probably didn't need coaxing to go in that tent and have sex with that woman. He probably thought, that's a great idea. And he was there. And she got pregnant. And they produced a kid. And they named that kid Ishmael. Right? You know this. I know you know this story better than me, but walk with me on this. I'm trying to build something here this morning. They named this kid Ishmael. God comes to Abraham and says, that was a good try, but he ain't the promise. He's not the one. The one I'm talking about is going to come from the impossible, Sarah's womb. It's going to have to come by a supernatural means. If it comes by a natural means, it has your fingerprints all over it. If it comes through a supernatural means, you know that it's God and it came from heaven. You understand so far? What are you going to do with this guy now? This kid's born Ishmael. Well, he can hang around for 13 years. Finally, in the 25th year, God lets Sarah have a child. She gets impregnated, the womb gets open, and she has a kid. Do you know what his name was? Isaac. And Isaac and Ishmael grow up in the house together. Right? And the Bible says Ishmael begins to taunt Isaac. And God goes to Abraham and says, cast the bondwoman out and her son. They cannot coexist together. They cannot live together. You understand that? Now go to Galatians chapter 5. I will show you something that's going to blow your mind if you haven't already heard this. Go to Galatians 5 and check this out. And you're going to understand exactly what I'm saying. And you're not going to like it, but it is the way God works. And you better get used to it, or I'll always be on the outside looking in. You're not in the end with God if you don't get this and admit it. So God goes to Abraham and says, cast the bondwoman out and her son. Right? Abraham says, oh, no, this is Ishmael. He thought Ishmael was his promised son. He thought this worked. But God said no. Cast Hagar, the mother you had sex with, and Ishmael, the son of the woman that you and her had sex and produced, cast them out. They cannot live with Isaac. They got to go. They got to go. Now, in what did I tell you? Galatians what? Galatians 4. In the all right, around verse 20. Do you find a scripture that Paul says, cast the bond woman out and her son? Verse 22. What's it say? Read it loud.
For it is written that Abraham had two sons.
For it was written Abraham had two sons. One from the bondwoman. And one by the free woman. The bondwoman is Hagar, producing Ishmael, who represents bondage. And then the other is the free woman, which is Sarah, who represents promise, freedom. Go ahead.
But whereas the child of the slave woman was born according to the flesh.
Okay, the kid that was born to the slave woman was born according to the flesh. Natural means. It didn't take God for Hagar and Sarah, or Hagar and Abraham, to produce Ishmael. Kids are being born every day. That's not a supernatural thing. That's you going into some woman and getting her pregnant and producing a kid. That is natural, and it goes on every day. Read on.
And had an ordinary birth.
Ordinary birth.
The son of the free woman.
The son of the free woman. Now, this is Sarah, whose womb was closed, got pregnant, produced Isaac. Read on.
Was born in fulfillment of the promise.
Was born in fulfillment of the promise. Any more?
Yeah.
Go ahead. What's up? What?
Now, all this is an allegory.
All this is an allegory. Now, see, understand something. Paul is giving you that Sunday school story you heard all your life as a kid. He's going to give you the supernatural, the revelation of why it's in the Bible. Sarah had to get pregnant by a supernatural means and produce a son called Isaac. Abraham, by natural means, produces a son called Ishmael. And this is the spirit versus the flesh. This is why they can't go together. This is why this morning when you walk into church, God's not going to take your flesh and put it alongside with what the Spirit is doing and then have a work of God in front of us. This is why Paul said, I put no confidence in the flesh. This is why we have to die to the flesh. We got to die to the natural means, because in order to have the supernatural operate in your life, you got to give up on your natural way of living and thinking and doing. The two can't go together. And he said that Ishmael and that Isaac cannot grow up in the same house together. And that's why God says, whether in your personal life or in the life of this church, you cannot come in here and try to manipulate God by getting in the flesh and doing things on your own. You got to wait for the Holy Spirit to show up and do it through you. Does that make sense? I can't alter or engineer and orchestrate my life through fleshly means. That's just me doing it. The whole world, that's how the world operates. This is how your government operates. You think your government's in a bad place? How'd they get there? Through their stupid thinking, relying on fleshly things, and putting us in a bad situation and circumstance. That's why you can't put no confidence in the flesh or man. You got to die to the flesh, die to the natural, and admit I am supernatural, and therefore I live a supernatural life, and I wait on heaven to do that. Now here's a perfect scripture. Now you're going to understand Matthew 6:33. Seek first the kingdom, and all these things are added unto you. Now you're going to understand that scripture better. Let's rephrase it. Seek first the supernatural, and all the supernatural gets added to you through by the natural. In other words, God will take the supernatural, bring it into the natural, and produce something for you. Just like he did Sarah. He, supernatural God, came on a natural woman and opened up her natural womb and made it supernatural. And when you seek the kingdom, you're seeking the supernatural and you're waiting on the supernatural. And then God comes down, uses the natural, and opens something up for you called God's will. Now, when I'm seeking the kingdom, that's how things get added to me. I don't seek the natural to manipulate the natural in order to get more of the natural. I've had enough of the natural. It doesn't work. It's a disappointment. Every time I put my hand to the natural, I get disappointed. Even if it's fun for a while, sin for a season, I end up getting screwed. Date the wrong woman, the first couple months is bliss, but the rest of it is hell on earth. And then you got to get rid of them. Hey, you know this, right? They get a new job, the first 2 weeks, they all love you. It's great with the first 2 weeks. Everybody loves you. They might even get a cake. They might even buy your lunch. But trust me, in 3 months, they're going to cuss behind your back and wish you weren't even there. You buy a vehicle. You love driving it for the first 2 months till it begins to manifest it's a lemon. Then you start soaking a lot of money in it. I'm telling you, I speak through experience, whether it's marriage, whether it's job, whether it's a vehicle, or even a damn house, money pit. I'm telling you, if God ain't in it, it's going to screw you in the end. And when you get to my age, I understand if you're in your 20s, you're going to have to create a bunch of Ishmaels. I understand it. I have so many damn Ishmaels living out there. And I've had to kill them sooner or later. In this case, God says, cast the bondwoman out and her son. I had to kill the Ishmael. I had to walk away from it. Are you getting this? This is the biggest problem the church has. I'm not playing with you. The church is nothing but a major Ishmael. Because all we do is try to produce stuff after ways and means of our carnal thinking. Church growth techniques, that's Ishmael. If God doesn't grow the church supernaturally, anything you do other than that is an Ishmael. And you may have a big church with a nice paved parking lot and a 14-string instrument orchestra, and you got the best thing, and you got YouTube Now video in your worship services. Oh, you have arrived. No, you haven't. Not if it's an Ishmael. You think what you see as a success is God. Success, it does not define God. In fact, God will test you. How many believe God tests? He said, I brought you into the wilderness. I could have took you straight to Canaan, but I brought you through the wilderness in order to test you. I already know what's in your heart. You don't know what's in your heart. So I'm going to engineer and orchestrate a situation for your life, and I'm going to let the old natural come out. See, when everything's going okay, it's, thank you, Jesus. God is so good. He answers all my prayer. I just love Jesus. I love the church. I'm so glad to be born again. And then when nothing goes your way, it's like, what the hell are you doing, dude? God, come on. You bring me this far to leave me? And then the true callers come out of who you are. You know, you come here and you raise your hands and you love on God. I want to see what you do in the own privacy and confines of your home when the crap hits the fan. That's who I want to see. You see me here. You ought to see me when you're not here. You hear all good things right now. You ought to hear what comes out of my mouth when you're not around. I have it out with him. You say, well, that's just disrespectful. It's in my heart anyway, is it not? Does he not see? I'd be fake with God if I kept my cussing in my heart and not tell him about it. He says, let it out. I see it anyway. I hear it anyway. Let it out. And then after I let it out, let me tell you something about Psalms. How many times does David bitch and complain in the Psalms in the very beginning of almost every Psalm? He's bitching and complaining about what's happening in his life. Have you noticed the trend? And then in the middle, he switches and ends up saying, but God, you're good. God, I trust you. Nevertheless, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm not going to fear no evil. Why? He vented. As he's venting, he realizes, man, what am I saying? And he gets a revelation of God, and he twists the psalm around. He always ends it on a good note. Get real with God. God doesn't want fake. Don't go to God with this plastic mask on your face of how great thou art, when in your heart, you're kind of ticked off at him. Tell him about it. Because in the telling, revelation comes, and you go, oh, okay. Jesus was in the garden struggling. He didn't want to go to the cross. His flesh did not want to go to the cross. So he goes in his own way to bitch and complain to God. Maybe not in the way you bitch and complain, but he's going to God saying, is there not another way we can do this? It was so intense between him and the Father that he sweat drops of blood. The vessels in his, what is it? What was it? Where there's vessels at? I'm not a doctor. I'm not medical. But there's, you know, whatever that dynamic was going on in his forehead through the intensity of the pressure. You don't know either. They broke and mixed in with the sweat, producing blood. But he concludes, nevertheless, it ain't about me, not my will, but your will be done. God knows that he is going to drag you through a knockdown, drag out fall before you get with the program. Why? Because the flesh never wants to obey God. God has a plan and your flesh will always buck it. Or once in a while, your flesh may like what God says, so you try to help him out, like Abraham did with producing an Ishmael. Now, sermon number 3. Why does God give promises? Why didn't he just tell me to go do something? Why is promise in dark contrast to performance? God's not going to ask you to do anything because that would cause you to be the performer. He who began a good work will perfect it or perform it, not you. He who began a good work will bring it to completion, not you. You never work. That's why it says labor to enter into rest. He's not asking you to do anything. He's asking you to do Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord. All he asks you to do is seek first the kingdom. He adds these things supernaturally to your life. He knows you need a house. He ain't against you having a house. He knows you need a car. He ain't against you having a car. He's against how you will manipulate ways and means in the flesh to try to get that car. You know, we have a trend happening in this church. Everybody's buying new cars. That's a good thing. But if I go and get a new car and I get the best interest rate because I got good credit, I can brag. I can boast. How'd you get that car? I got good credit, meaning I paid my bills on time. I don't owe nobody nothing. But if I can pull off getting a loan with bad credit, how'd that happen? Well, they're just giving loans to everybody up there at that bank now, aren't they? People still get denied with loans, don't they? I know this person who bought a car. Ain't nobody here, so don't think it's anybody in this church. It's nobody in this church. And I'm thinking, they ain't getting that loan. I know them. There is no way in hell they're getting that loan. I know their credit history. I know them personally. They ain't getting that loan. In fact, why I know that, their first loan, I had to co-sign for it. So I knew they're going to get a better vehicle, and I ain't co-signing this one. I'm just not doing it. It's way more money. I ain't co-signing. Because I know I'm going to need a vehicle someday. And I know this person pulled it off. They got the loan. And I even said to this person, what? Are they giving loans to anybody nowadays? Huh? No, what I'm saying is, if God wants you to have that vehicle, you're having it. If he's got to split the Red Sea, you're going to get that vehicle no matter what. Why? Because if you can pull off a loan with bad credit, you can't boast. Can you? Now, I'm not saying go out and get bad credit to prove God he's supernatural. You don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm saying it doesn't matter. If God says you're to have something, it doesn't matter. And that's what I was trying to say to you. And can I be honest with you? Can I correct you in front of the whole world? He had a audition for the episode Outsiders in Pittsburgh, and you did terrible. You before he would do good, felt good about it. Still didn't get a part, but he did good. He did the part, didn't do it very well. And I said to him, it doesn't matter whether you do the part good or bad. If God wants you to have that part in that television show, you're going to get it. And I would venture to say, he'll probably have you do bad just to show you not to ever have confidence in the flesh. In your, so either you call to do movies and TV shows, then it's not about you. It's about who him who calls. Not about you who does. Well, he didn't get the part. And then he turns around and says to me, because he didn't get it, he turns around, and I'm more good friends, so I can do this in front of him. He kind of goes, well, I know I did. I knew I was going to get it. I knew that part good. I didn't do that part good. That director probably didn't even give the, or who was it? The casting director probably didn't give the tape to the director because I did so bad. And I didn't correct him because I picked my battles with people. Sometimes I'll correct some, but I'm thinking he didn't get it. He didn't hear what I said. It doesn't matter whether you do good or bad. It matters on whether he calls you to have the part or not. Go up there and have fun. Go up there and enjoy yourself and get the worry and the burden of you performing off your back. It's probably why you did bad, because you had that burden to do good, to be the best that you can be. Nobody can be the best that they can be. I stopped that being the best that I can be years ago. I would always try and think, I'm as a young preacher, I got to preach the best. Every sermon has to be my best sermon. That's what they tell you. My next sermon should be my next. I gave that crap up a long time ago. I'm not trying to find great words and be an orator and be very articulate in what I say and come up with nice illustrations and allegories and types and shadows and figures and watch my grammar. I don't care how I say anything. I give up on that. Paul even said, I didn't come with you with superiority of speech. He gave that up a long time ago too. I'm just trying to convey a truth here. It may come out good. It may come out bad. I may bomb. I don't care. I'm here doing it. And if God wants the message to speak to you, it'll speak to you no matter what I look like and how I sound. Right? You've got to quit putting confidence in the flesh because you're not natural. The minute you start performing, you're in the natural. You've got to say, it ain't about me, it's about what he wants. I mean, he goes and picks Moses, and that's the worst. Why? He's a murderer. Pharaoh's going to know that's the guy who killed one of his own men. Pick somebody else out. Don't pick Sarah. She's barren. Pick out a woman that's fruitful and can multiply like rabbits. Pick out a woman who can produce like rabbits. That's the good candidate. How about David? The prophet Samuel is told to go pick out the next king. So he goes into Jesse's household and says, line up all your boys out here. Now this is prophet the Samuel, who's the most holy man on the planet of the earth in that day. Him and God talk a lot. So he ought to know who the next king is, right or wrong. So Jesse parades all his boys out there. You know the story. I hate telling these stories because you already know them. He parades all these boys out there. And they're all military men. And they're all great candidates to be the next king. And Samuel's looking at him. And Samuel is now Eliab, E-L-I-A-B, however you want to pronounce it. Now that boy, look at the muscles. Look at the stature. Look at the ability of this man using the sword. Damn, that is the next king. That is the next king. And he's getting ready to anoint him. And God says, whoa, you're looking at the natural. Is that what he says? God says, all you see is the natural. Yeah, he acted good. Put him in the part. Yeah, he's got a better education. Give him the job. See, that's how you think. And you limit yourself when you allow yourself to think in natural ways and means and terms. And the prophet was thinking natural. And God said no. So he says, okay, Jesse, none of these boys are king. I don't get it. I asked you to parade all your boys out here, and God's saying none of them. Do you have another kid? Oh, yeah. He's some skinny teen up there watching a few scraggly sheep. But he's you don't want him. And Samuel said, go get him, because none of these boys are the one. So here's this boy who's an artist. He's not a military man. He didn't go to, what's the academy? Our academy, military academy? He didn't go to West Point. All these boys went to West Point. This guy went to some liberal arts college. He's artistic. He likes to paint. He has a harp. He writes songs. He sings to God. I'd say he's gay. Not, that's probably mean, wasn't it? But you know, he's maybe a little feminine. But he ain't the one. So Samuel goes up there and God says, that's the man. Wait a minute, this guy's got a guitar in his hand, he's got long hair, and he doesn't he's like a hippie, he doesn't even shave, he doesn't shower, he's around sheep, he's got to smell like sheep. He's got a guitar in his hand. Give me the Eli with the sword in the hand. So this guy has two options, the hippie, artistic guy with a guitar in his hands that sings songs. Or this military guy who's got a sword in his hand can take your head off and take you down in 2 seconds. Who's the next king? See, in the natural, none of us would have picked David. Quit living out of the natural, and you've got to start admitting you're supernatural, and you've got to start living by that ways and means. Let me tell you why God gives promises. Because if he gives you steps, secrets, and keys, you can do it. How do I know when I'm really hearing God? He's going to tell you something you yourself can't even do. Why do you need faith for something you know your natural ways and means can do it? Don't, you know what? Let's say you need a job. How many think they can get hired? Say, we were at McDonald's last night. And what did it say? Love, you got to love your job. You love your job, work for us. And we were making fun of that because it's like now they got to manipulate you, brainwash you. You think it's fun working at McDonald's because they can't get nobody. So they got to tell you that it's, and then we said, well, just, we started looking at the people and they all look miserable. They ain't nobody there loving their job. That's false advertisement. But my point is, how many people here think they can get a job at McDonald's? I guarantee you, they are so hard up, and they even let you have your own schedule. Hey, we'll even let you pick your own schedule. We're so hard up. Right? We can all. Now, does it take faith to go put an application at McDonald's? No faith whatsoever, and you have enough natural ability to work there. Hey, it does. Do you know that they hire handicapped people to work at McDonald's too that aren't all there? Did you know that? Do y'all know that? I think that's a great thing, honestly, that they will hire somebody who's not all there. I'm going to say it as nice as I can be. I don't know. Can't call them handicapped, can't call them retard. I don't know what they call them now. Mentally challenged? Huh? I think that's a great thing. That McDonald's is hiring mentally challenged people. But what's that say about you getting a job there? Well, hell, if he can get a job there, I know I can get one. It doesn't take faith to get a job at McDonald's. So if God says, go get a job at McDonald's, it ain't going to take much faith. But if he says, go get a job at NASA, oh, we're... I can't even fill out the application. I stop with my name and address because I got nothing to give them on after that. After race, after name, address, social security number, they're wanting things I ain't. But if God says you're going to get a job at NASA, I can put that application in blank with just my name and phone number. And if God says I'm to work there, I'm telling you, I will get a job there. So don't go looking for a job you know you can get. There's no faith in that. Ask God, where am I supposed to get a job? And man, listen, every promise in the Bible, it seems to me that every time God told somebody to do something, it took his supernatural backing to get it done, because the man in and of himself could never ever do it. Now, why don't we live like that and quit trusting in ourselves? That's why Paul said, I put no confidence in the arm of the flesh. You live a meager existence, a miserable existence, a natural like existence, all life is, because all we do is confess our naturalness, which confesses our limitedness, and we never see God work in the supernatural because we never get out of the natural thinking and get over into the supernatural thinking so he can work in supernatural ways and means and give you things you could never get on your own. You accomplish things you could never get accomplished on your own. Stop the natural thinking. Because God will never use your natural tendency, your natural bents. He won't use anything. You disqualify yourself daily from supernatural impossibilities because you think too natural. Well, I'm not of the right race. I'm not of the right IQ. I'm not of the right background. I don't have that education. You already limit yourself from anything God could possibly do bigger than what you're already experiencing. God has given me promises. And I got to close. Here's why he gives promises. To beat the flesh out of you. Why did it take 25 years for Sarah's womb to open? Because it took 25 years to beat the flesh out of Abraham. Because we already saw him getting in the tent with Hagar. Why does God give impossible dreams? That you cannot. That's why it requires faith. If God's told you, showed you something, and it doesn't require supernatural ways and means, it ain't God. Because you can do it on your own, can't you? When God gives a promise, and you know that it's a promise from God, when you think, oh my God, there's no way, you'd be embarrassed to share it. Because they'll think, that's a pipe dream. There's no way that's going to happen for you. So you're embarrassed to tell anybody something you heard in the spirit. Because you know in the natural, there's no way that's going to happen. And you kick it back to God and think, that's just me. And God's like, what must I do to convince you of my supernatural powers and my ability to do anything that's impossible? All things are possible. When are we going to get that? If we understand that all things are possible, then we become ready for God to implant within us every dream and vision he wants to accomplish if all things are possible. And then when I hear him speak something, I'm not going to kick it back at him because I can't do it. I'm going to say, okay, God, then you do it. And that means I can't do anything to help him along the way. The purpose of promise versus performance is if it's something you can do, it's performance. And God ain't on it. It's got your fingerprints, and you can get glory out of it. You can take credit for it. But if it's something that he gives you that you know you can't do, and even when you try to help, you fall flat on your face. God has given me promises, and in the beginning, I tried to help God out. But I think, well, I'll do this, thinking it's an act of faith. And he's like, I am not going to let you have your fingerprints on this. You're going to see that it's all me and none of you. That's with deliverance. If you're trying to get over addiction, don't try to help God out by going to some 12-step program. That's natural ways and means to overcome something that's you can't. Look to God's supernatural power and his ability to lead your life. That's why you're born of the Spirit. You're born of the supernatural because your life is supposed to be supernatural. And in order to keep you in the supernatural, he's going to give you promises. If he doesn't give promises, you're going to always do what you can do in the natural. How many believe in budgets? Financial budgets. That's you knowing how to put money aside to pay your bills. How about hearing God, trusting him, and letting the supernatural money come in? Every time I do a budget, I always freak out. I haven't done a budget. I'm tempted to do a budget now that I bought that vehicle. But I haven't had it. I haven't done a budget. I don't know how long. And he always provides. And I'm not rich. He always provides. Put the supernatural on your finances, guys. That's all I'm saying. Or live that minimum wage, hand to mouth, foot to mouth, whatever, and just get by. And worry on top of it. And fight with your spouse over it. You know divorce is a result of sex and money more than anything, a result of money and sex. You know what I say to guys? Give the finances to God and stop wanting to have sex so much. And both of those take supernatural ways and means. God, you can't tell a guy to quit wanting sex. He can't. You'll only want it more. You can't tell a guy to stop spending. He'll only want to spend more. But if you get the supernatural spirit on your sex and on your God on your money, and on, everything starts flowing. You put the supernatural on your marriage. You put it on the family. You put it on the kids. If you're going to go after this thing in the natural, I promise you, you're going to get screwed and you're going to fail. And it's going to be miserable. Finances, relation, kids. Everything is just going to be... You might have some ups. They always turn to downs. Good times, bad times. How about just getting the supernatural on every single aspect of your life? Seek first the kingdom. He takes care of everything. Now go to Proverbs 3:5 and I'm done. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Not the arm of the flesh. Not ways and means, what you can come up with or what somebody else tells you to do. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Now look at the next part. Lean not on your own understanding. What's he saying? Lean not on the natural. When he says trust, guys, get this. He says trust in the Lord. He's saying trust in the supernatural. Lean not on the natural. In all your ways, acknowledge the supernatural. And he will what? Set the course of action in the natural through the supernatural. In all your ways, acknowledge the supernatural, and he will direct your paths in the natural. You can't lose if you keep seeking the supernatural. Admit it. Damn it. I'm supernatural, whether you like it or not. And I'm going to keep saying it. I'm supernatural. I'm no longer natural. I am supernatural, and I'm going to live supernaturally. Now, the lost is going to think you're whacked out. They already do if you're saved. Jesus living inside of you. You're an idiot. You're a Jesus freak. They don't think too kindly of you anyway, being saved. So just go all the way. I'm supernatural. You know, when I bought that vehicle, I had people say, "You got to get a warranty." No, I had barely afforded it the way it was. Get a warranty. Got to do this, got to do that. And you start freaking out. Well, maybe I should... Wait a minute. Did God lead me there? Did God open that door? Did God make that happen? He's my warranty. Sorry, I live supernaturally. Well, if God gave me a vehicle, why do I need a backup plan for it? What, is this gift not good enough? Did he lead me to the... Maybe led me to the wrong vehicle that I got to back? I mean, now we start thinking that we got to have God's back rather than God having our back. I'm sorry, I'm just refusing to live the way I've lived the first 50 years of my life. I'm done. I have to admit it myself. I am supernatural, and I believe in a supernatural God who only moves through the supernatural. He mixes everything up in the natural by being supernatural. He can create 10 plagues on a natural field, natural realm. 10 plagues came out of nowhere. How does a Nile turn to blood? Where's all these locusts come from? And now I'm facing the Red Sea. Ain't no time in history of life has anybody ever split at a Red Sea that people can go through dry land. Who circles a city 7 times? The most powerful a city that you don't have the ability to penetrate. And who circles it 7 times and blows trumpets? Who goes out to the biggest army to fight the biggest, most powerfulest army, who goes out to fight and puts the choir in front of them? And the guys with the swords don't even get to fight. The choir gets to sing. And God puts the enemy to flight. Go through the Bible. God ain't going to work naturally in your life. So admit it. Suck it up. The natural stops today. Damn it, I'm supernatural, and I'm going to start living that way. Amen. God bless you. I'll see you next week.